Hey folks, I've been having a great time doing these TerraGenesis dev diaries for the last few weeks. So last week, I posted a poll in our Facebook fan group and asked what they wanted me to talk about next. And overwhelmingly, they came back and said they wanted to hear about how the planets were rendered in-game, how we represent the changes that you're doing to your world. So this week, let's talk about planets. Now, when I was making TerraGenesis, I had one big obstacle. I didn't know how to do graphics, really. I was an app developer, not a game developer. And so I knew how to do menus and tables and different pages and buttons, but I didn't know how to do, like, characters or environments or anything like that. I didn't know how to use a game engine like Unity. TerraGenesis was originally developed as an iOS native app in the same way that, like, the Mail app is. So right from the beginning, I knew that this was going to be a largely menu-based game because that's what I was capable of making. But when you've got a game about transforming a planet, the one thing that you absolutely have to do is show the planet. We had a bunch of different metrics in the game, and so I wanted to make sure that every metric was represented visually some way. And luckily, for most things, that's pretty easy. If you're raising the sea level of a planet, you're gonna see water on the planet. If you're introducing biomass to a planet, you're gonna see green on the surface. There were a few that I had to kind of fudge in terms of how they're represented, most notably the oxygen content, which isn't really visible from space. I ended up fudging it so that the atmospheric color was tinted based on your oxygen levels. Blue is just right, red is too little oxygen, yellow is too much oxygen. That's not really how that works, but I needed a way of representing oxygen. Everything else was obvious. High pressure means more clouds. High sea level means more water. Originally, as weird as it is to say, there was no temperature mechanic in the game. But once I added it, it became obvious how to represent temperature. Ice. So those were the five areas that I knew I wanted to be able to show on the planet's surface. Water, ice, biomass, pressure, and oxygen. In addition to that, I knew I wanted to be able to do city lights to show where your cities were and how big they were growing. And then, of course, a big part of the appeal of TerraGenesis was going to be the planet. The thing underneath all of those effects, just watching Mars, getting to know what Venus looks like, getting to know what Pluto looks like, or even the moon. Using those textures from NASA really helped bring the game to life in a way that no artist could have been able to do. I say that, except an artist totally could do it, because several of the planets were incompletely mapped. Several of the moons of the gas giants, several textures provided by NASA are incomplete. So I ended up hiring an artist to flesh out the other sides of those worlds. When you look at Pluto in the game, half of Pluto is accurate according to science, and half of it is an artistic representation of what the rest of that world might look like, because we don't know. The first real innovation in the development of TerraGenesis that really allowed the whole thing to happen was an idea I had back in 2015 about how you could render oceans on an alien world easily. And we do that using height maps. Height maps are grayscale maps of a planet where lighter colors represent higher elevation and darker colors represent lower elevation. For pretty much any planet and moon in the solar system, you can find these online from NASA. What I realized was you could very easily filter out pixels of different colors, and doing so, isolate the areas of the planet that would be above or below sea level. You could effectively use the height map as a mask and reduce the areas that you didn't want, and what was left would be the ocean. And then you would just need to tint it blue, and you would have functionally an ocean on your planet that was accurate to the topography of that world. And we wouldn't have to do any fancy calculations or anything like that. It's literally just a matter of picking a number on a scale of 0 to 1 and saying, show everything below this number. You can actually try this out yourself. There are diffuse maps, which are the colorful surface maps of Mars, and then height maps available on Google Images. Pull them into Photoshop or something similar, and you can overlay the height map onto the diffuse map, and then use a Luma key to reduce the brighter pixels or the darker pixels to get just the areas of the map that are above and below a certain elevation. That way we could do the sea level and then also the ice level by inverting that information and only using the higher elevation pixels, or the ones closer to the poles. Now, there have been basically two eras of TerraGenesis's history. The first was when it was an iOS native app. And then we completely rebuilt the game from the ground up as an iOS and Android app using Unity. The way we represented the planets on those two platforms were completely different. In iOS, I wasn't programming it like a game. I wasn't using any of the systems that Apple has for doing advanced graphics because I didn't know how. I was just programming this as an app. So what I came up with was sort of a Russian nesting doll design, where you had a sphere that you would map the texture of the planet's surface onto, and then you have a very slightly larger sphere around it that you would generate the water map and put that on there, and the rest was transparent so that you could see the surface of the rock. And then outside of that, there would be a biomass map, and then outside of that, atmosphere, and outside of that, clouds, and they would all be just barely larger than each other, and you would rotate them in sync so it looked like one object. This was incredibly inefficient, incredibly cumbersome. It got the job done, but like, oof, really bad performance for a game with pretty much one graphical asset. It also required us to generate and then store different textures. So if you opened up TerraGenesis back in those days, you would see a long list of texture files at different levels of a planet. It would be like Mars at 5% water, Mars at 10% water, Mars at 15% water. And so the app took up a huge amount of storage space because we were generating all these different textures so that we could use them when we needed them. At the end of the day, it worked. It wasn't great. There were bugs in the process and it was really inefficient, but you know, it got the job done. Generate each texture individually, layer them on top of each other, and it'll look like what you need it to look like. The problem was that we were constrained to this idea that each layer was distinct from the others. You couldn't have something that was beneath one of the lower layers, but on top of one of the higher layers. Everything had to be done in order. And there was no complex processing. There was no way to do really intricate detail. It was literally just shells, one inside the other. So when I started hiring developers and we started doing the conversion into Unity, I got really excited at the prospect of using a game engine to render these worlds, because all of a sudden, we had access to shaders. I did not know how to do shaders. No one knew how to do shaders. I figured out some stuff about shaders, but they're still magic to me. For the non-programmers out there, a shader is a system that calculates graphics on the fly as needed. So you set up logic for how to display something on screen, and it will generate it frame by frame as needed. Gone were the days of us having to generate separate textures and then save them and load them and apply them to separate spheres. Now we had one sphere with one shader on it, and it took in all of the data that we needed and processed it accordingly and generated the planet that we wanted to see. Not only was this hugely more efficient from a processor standpoint, it also allowed us to do so much more complex ideas with our planets. We started layering in new detail and nuance. We added atmospheric sheen and distribution along the sunset edge. We added varying levels of biomass based on your temperature. So if you had a habitable world but it was really hot, maybe only the biomass is around the poles. Or if you have a habitable world but it's very cold, maybe the only biomass is around the equator. Shaders were also beneficial because they allow you to play with the settings right there in the editor. You can literally just grab a slider or change a number and see the changes represented on screen immediately. In the old way, we would have to generate separate textures individually and then load up a new game with those textures. It was hugely inefficient. And now, we can just play with it until we find something that looks good. And as we started to add more detail and more nuance into the shader logic, we also realized that we could do new stuff. We added villages. We added lava worlds. We added all sorts of new stuff that really brought these worlds to life and added a lot more nuance. That is something that I'm always looking for in TerraGenesis, is how to differentiate worlds. I've always disliked the idea that my Mars is going to end up looking just like your Mars, that it's all just green and blue and, you know, everybody's got roughly the same sea level. I like finding ways to differentiate worlds. And so adding things like atmospheric diffusion, adding things like differing the biomass based on your temperature or, you know, lava worlds, all these different things that you can do with your planet really help bring the game to life. So that's how we handle planets in TerraGenesis. We're constantly refining the planet's shader these days. Pretty much every update includes some little refinement, either to make it perform better or to add a new feature, add a subtle little detail to make it look a little bit better. The planets are the heart and soul of TerraGenesis, not to mention pretty much our one marketing asset. And so we are doing everything we can to make them look as good as possible. That's it for this week's Dev Diary. I'm going to be posting polls each week in the TerraGenesis fan group on Facebook asking what you want the next episode to be about, so be sure to check it out and see what the options are. In the meantime, I want to do a special shout out to our patrons who have been so good to support us and our indie dreams for several years now. This week I want to shout out Brian, C, Emmy, Kyle, and Marine. Thank you so much for your support. If you want to join our Patreon and get access to special videos, behind-the-scenes content, and a lot of great benefits, be sure to check out patreon.com/edgeworksentertainment. We've also got a lot of exciting content coming up on YouTube, so be sure to check out Slice of Science, our two-minute animated science show, and The Synthesis, where Lacey and I go through movies, books, and television and talk about how they represent real science in entertainment. Be sure to subscribe and hit the bell so you're notified about all our upcoming videos. Have a great week, and as always, happy terraforming.